Tonight, Fijians celebrate 43 years of independence with pomp and ceremony. As others stood in solidarity, praying for the nation. And local economists go head to head in a heated debate. Very good evening and happy Independence Day to you all, our viewers from here in Fiji and across the region and around the world. Fiji today celebrated 43 years of independence from British rule when it gained sovereignty in 1970. Our coverage began in the capital city with a march from the Republic of the Fiji Military Forces and the Fiji Navy in Albert Park. The 3rd Battalion led the parade. A total of 476 soldiers were part of the Trooping of the Colors, which was observed by the President Ratuepeli Nailatikau. In attendance as well was the Prime Minister Commodore Borenge Bainimarama, and as tradition dictates, there was also the 21-gun salute. And people came out in numbers decked in blue to commemorate Fiji Day. Fiji One News caught up with a handful to find out what our independence meant to them.
I live in Australia and it's about 23 years I come back to Fiji, and this is the long time I haven't been see the Fiji Day, except today I've seen it again. And I'm very happy, I'm very proud of it. I'm very proud of people of it in Fiji.
Happy Fiji Day, I love Fiji!
It's a very special day for Fiji because they're celebrating people coming at Albert Park, enjoying the view and the smiles of the Fijian. You can see tourism. They're coming over to Albert Park and enjoying celebrating the Fiji Day.
Fiji Day is a day which unites Fiji together. And also, I believe it brings unity, irrespective of your culture, your ethnic, or whatever. Fiji Day is just bringing people together.
We celebrate Fiji independent from Great Britain.
And how are you spending your day?
I'm spending time with my family today to celebrate Fiji Day.
As the whole nation today stood still and celebrating our 43 years of freedom, some spent the day in silence. The Fiji Council of Churches with Femlink today held a peace vigil in the capital, offering prayers for the nation.
This group of people today chose not to be part of the noisy Fiji Day celebrations. Instead, they resorted to spend the day in silence with heads bowed in prayer, appreciating our proud history and praying for the nation.
This is one symbol of solidarity. And as I said, it's an ongoing peace-building initiative since 2000, because we believe that the work towards peace-building must continue.
Given the fact that Fiji is a multicultural society, organizers of the vigil say people of all faiths should come forward to pray for the nation, especially at a time when Fiji is in transition towards democracy.
If we look back in history, 43 years ago on the 10th of October 1970, the role of the faith community and the recognition of the role of the faith communities in Fiji was a major part of our independence celebrations. There was an ecumenical and an interfaith service that took place in Albert Park as well.
Civil society organizations have also been urged to participate in such events.
It's important that at this time, whether they are putting up a lovo and or whatever they are doing for Fiji Day, whenever they say grace or they're prayer for their meal, that they also pray for the country as well. So this is just our support for this day, and to encourage the people of Fiji, our brothers and sisters, both our brothers and sisters in Christ and our friends of the different faith communities, to spend a little bit of time just reflecting on the country.
Halitestad, Fiji One News.
And the island nation of Kiribati has joined in on our Fiji Day celebrations. President Anote Tong acknowledged the growth in relations between the two countries. He said both Fiji and Kiribati have continued to enjoy close, warm and friendly relations over the years based on shared values, aspirations and challenges as Pacific small island developing states. He also thanked the government's continued commitment to further strengthening closer cooperation with Kiribati at the bilateral, regional and international level. And the President of Singapore, Dr. Tony Ten Keng Yam, has also conveyed his congratulations to the people of Fiji. Along with many celebrated the significance of our 43 years of independence around the country today, for the people of Saunaka village in Nandi, it was also a momentous occasion. The village celebrated 100 years since the establishment on the 10th of October 1913. The overcast weather conditions in Nandi this morning did not deter the Ito Ke Naua and his people in Saunaka village from going all out to commemorate the significant event. Datuk Rangana Tauke Naua said while the lessons learned over the century will be a guiding light for his people, his only concern is the preservation of their culture and identity by the younger generation. Long gone are the days of circling Air Force planes, dropping miniature flags, other Fiji Day memorabilia and pineapple-shaped plastic juice bottles from the air to celebrate our independence from the British some 43 years ago. Today, Fijians instead show their patriotism by the vibrant blue colours they wear in countless designs that are synonymous with our independence celebrations. Madimbole Tamana takes a look at how this growing trend has settled in with our local retailers.
Over the years, Fiji Day celebrations have become more than just a public holiday. While putting up a flag and downing a lovo may be the in thing, going all out and being decked in blue is probably the more appropriate thing, not only when it's Fiji Day, but when it's the World 7 Series weekend and so on. That is why for Jacks of Fiji, providing an answer for that void is going big on clothing and memorabilia that has a Fiji flag on it.
We've always been proud of our Fijian heritage. My Fiji, my pride. We've been carrying Fiji merchandise for a number of years, and we specialize in various products from across the group, as you can see.
Established some 40 years ago in the jet set town of Nandi, Jack's has grown to be a renowned local brand, not only for the market here, but for the niche tourism market it serves and its outlets around the country.
Tourism is a very important part of the business, and we are seeing growth every year, and we are happy to be associated with Tourism Fiji.
Katri says the Fiji memorabilia sales isn't only compelling during Fiji's Independence Week, but whenever Fiji is playing in the World 7 Series and on a big occasion like the Rugby World Cup and so on.
Every visitor would like to take some part of Fiji souvenir, be it a Fiji flag or a Fiji souvenir t-shirt or a rugby ball, or it could be even any of the Fijian artifacts that we make.
He says Jacks of Fiji has all its products made locally, targeted providing the tourism market with the best option available to them.
Currently, the government is promoting Made in Fiji, and we are part of that and would like to see that we are able to promote and see that Fiji products are taken abroad.
Madimbole Tamana, Fiji One News.
Members of the public are advised that a trough of low pressure with associated cloud and rain over Fiji is gradually moving eastwards. It is expected to affect the group until midday tomorrow. Occasional rain over most places with isolated thunderstorms. Isolated heavy falls are also expected. Members of the public living in low-lying areas are advised to please take precautionary measures as the weather prevails. Localized heavy rain may lead to flash flooding. The public is further advised to monitor the situation and make necessary preparations. Stay tuned up next. Labour Ministry to complete a review of legislations. And Saved by Grace, villagers tag and release turtles out to sea. Hello again. As we celebrated our 43rd year of independence today, we should also not forget to protect the things that make us unique. In doing so, the World Wildlife Fund with the Department of Forestry tagged and released a turtle out to sea. This was in an effort to keep track of our distinct turtles.
This is the turtle that was accidentally caught by a fisherman some weeks ago. Today, this estimated 10-year-old endangered migratory species was granted freedom after being tagged by the Department of Fisheries and WWF.
We've got all the data from where it was caught and released. Right now, whoever's going to find the turtle monitor or fishermen or fisheries or other partners for turtle conservation, what they'll do, they'll record the same data, and then by that way we can keep track of the migratory paths of the turtle.
This is the third year of the 10-year turtle moratorium in the country. While the exact population of turtles have yet to be established, observations have been positive.
We are seeing more turtles. We are seeing more turtles when we walk out now as compared to about 10 years back. So it is working. And it is raising that awareness in community levels as well as to the life cycle, how long it takes a turtle to mature, and it impacts on their decision making as well.
50 to 100 turtles are tagged every year and released out in the sea by department with NGOs like WWF. Two cases are under investigation by the department on possible breach of the moratorium.
At present, whatever permit is given only for chiefly purposes, which comes through to our permanent secretary and to our minister, and which is then either approved or denied based on circumstances and scenarios and the need for turtle harvest, if there is such. But it is only restricted to chiefly purposes.
5 out of 7 species of turtles are found in Fiji. It's something authorities say we all should be proud of.
As much as possible, I'd like to encourage the people of Fiji that, you know, you don't have to be a scientist, you don't have to be a conservation person to look after all of our natural resources, and especially when it comes to turtles. If it hadn't been for the villages, we wouldn't have known.
Importance of turtles in our marine ecosystem can never be emphasized enough. Halit Eshtat, Fiji World News.
Two of our leading local economists last night went head-to-head in a heated debate on the proposed minimum wage for the country. Dr. Mahendri Reddy and who was tasked to carry out the national minimum wage survey stood strong to prove his point against Professor Wadanasi. Our reporter Halit Eshtat was at the debate and filed this report.
It was an evening on some serious discussions about our proposed minimum wage rate. After undertaking the survey in both formal and informal sector, FNU academic Dr. Mahendra Reddy discovered there was a major distribution problem in respect to wage rates, and he stood firm to prove his point.
Demonstrating that 68% of the workers are paid below mean wage rate, substantial. Some sectors having as high as 77% of wages below mean wage paid to the sectors. Number two, we found that 37% of the employees originate from households which are having income less than the minimum poverty line wage. Number three, we found that in agriculture sector, the wage rates, hourly wage rates are as low as 83 cents per hour.
Dr. Reddy in his survey found that the mean wage rate is higher than the median wage rate. Mean and medium wage rate in the formal sector is $4.37 and $3.83 respectively. Based on this, Dr. Reddy proposed the minimum wage rate to be 66% of median wage. That comes to $2.55. This in turn means that three sectors, namely road, garment and printing, will have to meet this requirement.
What we are doing is two things. One is to establish the national minimum wage. No employer will offer a wage rate below that. And secondly is that in this first shot, we are correcting the anomaly in these three sectors out of the 10 sectors. In the second shot, which is 1st January 2015, we fix the anomaly in the other three sectors of the 10 wages and councils. And then every 2 years, I'm suggesting that we use this internationally tested, scientifically based methodology to fix the wage rates of these 10 sectors where they will lie above this minimum wage, and of course also revise this the national minimum wage level.
On the rebuttal side, Professor Wadan Narse wasn't at all happy with the proposed minimum wage rate. Professor Narse says while he agrees with Dr. Reddy's proposal of moving people out of poverty, the minimum wage of $2.55 is not a practical amount.
The reality is that in the end, you've got to look at the capacity of employers to pay that minimum wage which you're setting. And if the work employers do not have the capacity, then no amount of legal decrees are going to enable that employer to pay the minimum wages. All that will happen is that if they're unable to pay, they will either close down their business or find some other trickery, you know, to actually get around that law.
Professor Narse added that the moral argument can't be used to set a minimum wage rate for the country.
Of course, there's elections around the corner as well. And suddenly a minimum wage of $2.30 is being declared when we all know that the reality is that those things don't work in PNG, Vanuatu, Solomons. They won't work in Fiji where employers are not able to pay. The way to go forward in this was to correct the problem of implementation of the previous WROs, which Dr. Reddy has pointed out. He should have asked himself, why did the Ministry of Labour not implement those WROs which the Wages Council had set under the Ministry of Labour's own legislation and gazettes?
After an hour-long debate, majority of the audience voted in favour of Dr. Reddy's proposal. Haliteshdat, Fiji One News.
And the public last night also had a chance to ask questions and put forward their suggestions to the Labour Minister as well as to both the economists. Questions came from all sectors of people, ranging from union leaders, employers and other academics. While union leaders were questioning the participation of unions in coming up with the minimum wage, some questioned the methodology of the survey.
Why did he say that the trade unions were not interested in the Wages Council? We were very much interested.
The people who are representing in that particular council, they were elected members or appointed members of the employees in the unionized sector. They were not reps of the non-unionized sector. So you can see real genuine interest was not there, because the unionized wage rates were far, far higher than the non-unionized wage rate.
I think he now agrees basically that there should be a minimum wage. I wanted to know whether he does support the idea that we should have a minimum wage.
What is the point of setting a national minimum wage when it cannot be enforced? The way to go forward would be to extend the Wages Council system, keep it operating, and make sure that you still have one chairperson of the Wages Councils who makes sure that all the meetings are held on time, the decisions are made on time every year, there are no delays year after year, and on these different sectors and so on, you set different wage rates given different employers' capacities to pay.
How scientifically rigorous is your survey?
The questionnaire was designed, a structured questionnaire was designed to look at individual employees' income and also the household income, because when you want to analyze how many of these workers are earning income below the poverty line income, you look at, and you want to compare the four-member adult equivalent poverty line income, then you look at the household income.
The Ministry of Labour, Employment and Industrial Relations hopes to complete the review of two major legislations governing our employment sector. The ministry is optimistic of completing the review of employment relations promulgation and workmen's compensation laws. Labour Minister Choni Osamate says this year will mark the end of reviews that started way back in 1991. The ministry has been able to review OHS, wages and productivity laws.
This has been a major exercise, spending a few years, and the Employment Relations Advisory Board will be finalizing its recommendations for changes before the end of this month.
The National Disaster Management Office has officially announced plans to relocate its office. The NDMO is planning to form a National Emergency Operations Center here at Selborne Street. That means all the agencies working during any disaster will work under one roof from here. NDMO Director Manasa Tangitakimbao says discussions are now underway to finalize the relocation. The Agriculture Ministry has sought the assistance of the Indian government for expertise in specific areas in our agriculture sector. Agriculture Minister Inia Siriratu met his Indian counterpart, Shri Sharad Pawar, in hope of boosting cooperation between the two countries in the agriculture sector. He also requested for an agronomist, veterinary specialist, and agricultural scientist to be deployed to Fiji through bilateral arrangements. Minister Pawar stated that India stood ready to support Fiji in all areas, such as offering assistance of a rice scientist, research for cultivation of potatoes, assistance for the dairy and coconut industry. We have the latest from around the region up next. Stay with us. Hello again. The Samoa Parliament has widened the scope for the selection of the country's police chief. Now, for the first time, non-Samoans can apply for the top spot. Talamua Online reports the Police Service Amendment Bill was rushed through Parliament under urgency yesterday. The new law means there is no longer an age restriction, nor a requirement that the commissioner must have had 10 years' service as a police officer. The current commissioner of police has been suspended to make way for an inquiry into allegations of nepotism and favoritism. Tonga's state-owned telecommunications operator says the country's new high-speed internet system has some hiccups to iron out. An 800-kilometer fiber optic cable system now links Tonga to Fiji via the Southern Cross Cable, which is the main trans-Pacific link between Australia and the United States. Tonga Communications Corporation, or TCC, is currently the only internet provider in the country using the cable. The board chairperson of TCC, Aloma Johansson, says there have been some problems since the launch in August, including congestion issues, adding the company is working to address the problem. And Jenny is next with sport, and our Sevens boys are ready for the Gold Coast tournament.
Yes, that's right. Our boys are raring to go, especially the three debutants who are fitting right in. Also ahead, how the Fairbrother was won after 80 minutes. And IDC football gets underway in Lautoka. With Fiji Day being celebrated in the country today, Fiji team in the Gold Coast are hoping to give something big to the nation this weekend. As Vashnil Prasad reports, the three debutants in the team are eager to make the first appearance for Fiji.
A lot will be in stake for the DGCL Fiji Sevens side in the Gold Coast Sevens. Out of the 12 players, three will make their IRB World Sevens debut this year, and former Ratunavula College Dean's Under-19 captain, Chita Thakumbu, confident enough to give his best.
Right now I feel happy and prepared myself for the Gold Coast here for this week. I'm happy to learning a lot of experience from the senior players, also from the coach Ben Ryan for this tournament.
Also watching the close moves during training, halfback specialist Waisea Nathungu, the 20-year-old called in as a replacement.
Yeah, I look forward for this tournament this week, and this is the first time I play for Fiji. I'll do my best.
And 22-year-old Benny Tambua Vudango expected to play a huge role on his debut in the tournament.
We'll take its game as a final. We won't treat them as any small teams.
Surely the bond in the team looks strong, as they only need is the support from the nation.
Well, boys are looking well, all gearing up for the game. For this weekend, we hope to bring a better result, as we always expected. We try to satisfy the fans back home on our what do you expect?
Fiji will get the title defense rolling with the first match against Canada on Saturday. In Gold Coast, Vashnil Prasad, Fiji One News.
The Gold Coast Sevens host Australia is brimming with confidence to win the tournament for the first time this year. The side hopes things will go well this time around, especially on the second day.
Stretching it out, the Australia Sevens team out to create history in the Gold Coast Sevens this weekend. Coach Michael O'Connor polishing on the final moves and hoping it'll be in their favour this time around.
Our aim is always to win, probably like every other team. So we need to do better on day two. We did reasonably well last year, day one, but day two is important.
These players will have a lot of hopes, especially being the host. They have a tough task from the first day after being pulled with Scotland, Argentina and Samoa.
It's a tough pool. We have Scotland first, then Argentina and Samoa. So very tough pool. Samoa played extremely well, I thought, on the weekend before it to beat Fiji. So it's going to be tough to get through.
Also with the same aim and hoping for a smooth go in the pool is Shannon Walker.
Still a bit better than last year and get through unscathed, I suppose. We got three hard games on the first day, so hopefully we get through them alright and bounce back on the second day.
The veteran player was out during the final training run with the team, but is hoping to be well before the first game.
The preparation's been pretty good so far. Ticked all the boxes, I suppose, and hopefully we can get there in the end on the weekend.
All in a hope to win the tournament for the first time this year. In Gold Coast, Vashnil Prasad, Fiji One News.
Amani Bosanawai proved to be a hero last night, kicking the winning penalty as Thai level snatched the Fairbrother Trophy from the tight grasp of United Siri. Under atrocious conditions, the two neighbours put up an entertaining classic in front of an excited crowd.
And smart, they've kicked it away! A penalty!
This was the decisive moment when it was finally all over. Under the floodlights last night, the Fairbrother Challenge No. 5 proved to be a classic as the weather failed to dampen the midweek rugby. In a night where players put their bodies on the line, it was Naita Siri's defence that held firm at a Thai level onslaught.
Going over Thai level. It's a penalty. Shepherding. And they're being held up. They need to use it. Naita Siri keeping them up and they've done well. Their numbers on the short side. There's Nakuitonga. And good tackle from behind.
An exchange each and Naita Siri led 6-3 at halftime.
We forced too much ball over there, offloads and everything. I think the second half, that's what we're going to work on.
The second half saw Thai level finally get over before Naita Siri scored a memorable try.
Now here's the counter attack, Naita Siri. One more man on the outside. He's taking off. It's a footwork. Naita Siri will score an unbelievable try.
Luveni Ali added another penalty as they led 14-13. Their defense kept Thai level at bay until they finally caved in. Substitute Amani Bosanawai kicking the winning penalty for the victory.
All hats off to Naita Siri, they're a champion team. We needed to dig deep.
Final score 16-14. Nandrunga next to challenge. William Tambuya, Fiji One News.
As part of their Fiji Day celebrations, the Vodafone Fiji Party took part in the day-long event at Elbow Park. This was followed by a light lunch hosted by their major sponsors at the Suva Bowling Club.
Vodafone Party team are here until Monday. Today as part of the Fiji Day celebration, we thought we'd bring them down and meet the people. It was a very great response. A lot of people came out to see who they are. I mean, most of them see them on the big screen. We give them an opportunity to see them up close and, personal.
They have relocated camp, moving from Pacific Harbour to the west.
We are checking out from Uprising. This is as we speak, and we have checked out, and we are traveling to Nandi to check in at Novotel. We spend 3 days there before we fly out on Monday morning.
The Vodafone Fiji Party's logistics to the Rugby League World Cup will not be a problem anymore. The DHL Express came on board with the Fiji Party, becoming their official logistics provider. They will handle all their logistics to and from the World Cup.
We sponsored some local teams, and Ilias Delana is our brand ambassador. So we've got a long tradition of supporting Fiji development and sport. So this is another opportunity for us. And we do have a global network in 220 countries around the world. We are the logistics experts, as you would say. So we're really proud and honoured to sponsor the national. And good luck to the Fiji team for the World Cup.
The Vodafone Fiji Party received a special treat yesterday. Their development partner, Esco Moros, put together a light lunch to wish the boys well. Although the side didn't stay long, they enjoyed tucking into the meal.
thanks for your welcome today. Obviously, thanks for your hospitality. Really enjoyed our little promos and getting out amongst the people. And again, thanks for your support.
Well, talk about awkward. Sonny Bill Williams is about to turn on his availability for the Kiwis World Cup defence. Yesterday he said no, today he said yes, signalling the end of the World Cup dream for one player, dividing the fans and putting New Zealand Rugby League in a rather embarrassing situation.
You know, Sonny is unavailable due to other commitments.
That was 9 a.m. yesterday. This afternoon we got this.
Sonny Bill's joining the Kiwis team for the World Cup later on in the end of the year.
The NZRL scrambling to make Williams' sudden change of heart to play in the World Cup happen. Last night, emergency phone calls were made to selectors and senior players.
He felt that in 2008, when he missed the last World Cup, that he'd missed an opportunity and he didn't want to miss this one, and he'd had time to reflect on it.
Williams today tweeted, "Without thinking the whole situation through thoroughly, I eagerly jumped at the chance to chill out and rest. I know the squad's already picked and I understand if I can't be part of it, but I'm here and ready to help the brothers if they want." But his inclusion has cost one brother his place in the squad. 21-year-old second rower Tohu Harris has been sacrificed.
It shouldn't have got this far, actually. It's been amateur hour in my view.
Former Kiwis coach Graham Lowe says the situation hasn't been handled well, but there's little fairness in professional sport.
In the cold, hard light of it all, we need to win the World Cup. And to do that, we need to have the best players. Sonny Bill is the best player on the planet. The Kiwis couldn't do without him.
Kearney met with Williams and his manager Coda Nasser in Sydney last Friday, 2 days out from the NRL Grand Final, 4 days before the Kiwis' announcement. Even then, Williams was undecided, but a phone call to Kearney on Monday night confirmed he was out. That was until the second call yesterday.
Whichever decision New Zealand Rugby League made, we're going to have some people that are going to go, that's a great decision, and others that are going to go, it's not a good decision.
The 28-year-old's rarely been available for the Kiwis. Between 2004 and 2008, he played just 7 games with 6 losses and a draw. But he's a different player now, a much more dangerous prospect for the opposition. Despite Williams' obvious ability, his inclusion throws into doubt the team's philosophy, loyalty, respect and integrity.
It's put everybody in a situation that they definitely didn't need in the initial parts of their build-up for this World Cup campaign.
If Kearney was feeling the pressure before, then the decision to add Williams has just tripled.
Nandi and Navua played to a 1-1 draw at the Courts IDC earlier today, and Suva started their campaign on a winning note, beating Dark Horses Nandronga 2-1.
Went over the top. Suva, though, they come back onto the attack, across the face of the goal, and now in the, off it goes, off the goalkeeper, and it is Samuel Andrunru.
In a goal se jitti hai, unke paas zyada tar advantage rehta hai.
And a sense before Alvin Andrunru. What a classic strike that is from Alvin. In the attack, a chip over the top, and coming out is the goalkeeper. Can he get away? Yes, a clever ten is still there, and it is that man that has done it again for Suva. Good work by him. Cool, calm and collected.
Meanwhile, Lambasa and Bar drew 1-1 in their first pool match. The future of Fiji hockey came together today for the MH Open Youth Olympic squad trials. 7 teams are in the capital putting their hands up for a chance to make the national under-17 side.
We actually trying to prepare a national team to play the Australians in December. And this team is also going to go on to the playoffs in Vanuatu and hopefully on to Nanjing in China for the Youth Olympics.
Teams have come in from Ba, Nandi, Lautoka and Levuka.
Selectors at work today. We'd probably name the 25 early next week. 25 boys and 25 girls to prepare for the Australian test. And then we intend to drop 10 of those children, and there'll be 15 preparing for the playoffs in Vanuatu.
5 records were broken in the opening day of the Fiji Short Course Nationals today. 204 local swimmers from 7 clubs are competing at the National Aquatic Centre. 5 clubs are from Suva, 2 from the West and 1 from New Zealand.
During the competition, they're giving our local swimmers a run for their money. Keeping them honest.
And that's our sports news tonight.
Thanks, Teddy. We have more on the government shutdown in the US in world news. Stay with us. lead our world segment with some breaking news. Rebels have kidnapped Libyan Prime Minister Ali Zidane and taken him to an undisclosed location. A spokeswoman told CNN that armed rebels escorted the Prime Minister from the Corinthian Hotel in Tripoli into a convoy of waiting cars. The witness reported no gunfire during the incident and said the gunmen were respectful and caused no trouble. Zidane's office initially called the abduction a rumor on its official Facebook page, but then it posted a note that said it was coerced by kidnappers to deny the report. Libya militias have run rampant since the revolution that ousted Muammar Gaddafi in 2011. Militias in the east of the country are demanding more autonomy from the central government and have severely constrained Libya's oil output, which is central to its export revenue. It's day 9 of the partial government shutdown, and leaders in Washington are pretty much in the same place as they were when it all started, nowhere. But there is a glimmer of hope as the House Democratic Caucus plans to meet at the White House this afternoon. Tori Dunnan has the latest from Washington.
On week 2 of the government shutdown, here's the problem. Both sides claim to want negotiations, but can't seem to agree on the terms. The president and Democrats are calling for the House to pass a government funding bill with no strings attached.
We have simple requests. Open the government. Let us pay our bills. We'll negotiate on anything you want to negotiate on.
Republicans say they're willing to negotiate, but only if Obamacare is on the table.
We want to reopen our government and provide fairness to all Americans under the president's health care law.
There is a small sliver of hope that could at least prevent the U.S. from defaulting on its debt. A source tells CNN Republicans may be open to a short-term extension of the debt ceiling, but only if President Obama agrees to negotiate. But that won't reopen the government, and the American people are feeling the pain of the shutdown. Up until today, families of fallen troops in Afghanistan were not getting death benefits, but the president has vowed to fix that.
He was not pleased to learn of this problem, and he has directed the OMB and his lawyers to find a solution, and he expects to have one today.
Bottom line, all of this will continue until lawmakers end the gridlock.
The fight to eradicate polio is becoming more dangerous than ever in Pakistan. It's one of only a handful of countries in the world where polio has not been wiped out. But extremists are targeting people who give the vaccinations. Militants earlier this week bombed polio workers near a hospital, killing 2 people and wounding 13 more. But health workers are defiant, saying it's worth the risk to try to stop the disease. The CNN's Saima Mohsin has more from Karachi in Pakistan.
Protecting children from polio with a few simple drops of vaccine has become a dangerous task. Not for the children, but for people like Gulnaz, who works in one of the most violent areas of Karachi, Pakistan's largest city. It's so dangerous, we can't use her full name. Last year, her niece and sister-in-law, also polio workers, were gunned down by armed boys on motorcycles. UNICEF says it was simply for giving young children this vital vaccination. But that hasn't stopped her.
Everybody in my family was suffering from shock. Some of them tried to stop me, telling me not to do this job anymore, because 2 coffins leaving one house leaves a mark.
Anti-polio campaigns have been targeted ever since U.S. intelligence used a fake vaccination program to help in its hunt for Al-Qaeda leader Osama bin Laden in 2011. That wasn't a polio campaign, but the damage was done. Since July 2012, 22 polio workers and escorting police have been killed. I asked Gulnaz if she's concerned about working in the same area after so many attacks, including the ones against her family.
After this tragedy, I'm not scared at all. In fact, I feel even stronger and more determined. Every woman in this country who is doing this job is praying for me. When I'm working in the field, I'm with my partner, but I also sense that my niece and sister-in-law who were killed are walking alongside me.
We couldn't film Gulnaz and Shazia in the area they usually work in for their safety and for our own. Because of the threat there, they have to be escorted by paramilitary soldiers, sealing off the area and guarding a street at each end, simply so that young children can be given these crucial drops that most parents and children around the world can get at their local doctor's surgery. Usman was infected with polio as a child, so he ensured his children took the drops. But after the bin Laden raid, he decided not to give them to his fourth child, three-year-old Musharraf, who became case number one for 2013. So far this year, 28 polio cases have been detected in Pakistan.
I'm not stupid or illiterate. I made sure my other children got the drops. But I was very angry and wary of aid workers, because if they are cooperating with spy agencies, then it's better to keep away from them. I am sad my youngest suffered, but I don't regret my decision.
Usman only changed his mind after the government released a booklet with a series of religious edicts from Muslim scholars telling parents polio drops are safe.
I am appealing to my fellow Pashtun society to give their kids polio drops.
It's a message healthcare workers hope others will hear. It could make their jobs safer, and for the children, it could save them from a lifetime of avoidable disability.
And finally, in world news tonight, De La Rue is one of the world's largest money makers. The UK-based firm is involved in the production of more than 150 currencies, including Fijian notes. CNN was granted exclusive access to its printing press. It's the first time for a CNN crew to be allowed into De La Rue's security design center.
Every banknote is individual. The banknote itself actually starts to speak about the culture of that particular country, and obviously many countries are proud of their cultural background, so it's important that we capture that in essence onto a banknote. The banknotes really is the calling card to the international market about what that country is really about. This is one of our house banknotes which celebrates the 200 year anniversary of De La Rue. The heron was put on there to show some of the features on our polymer substrate, showing the clear substrate when it penetrates through, and therefore the heron's dip his beak in through the water. This particular banknote is about flora and fauna of the UK, but you're trying to capture technology, capturing famous or historic people, or capturing wildlife of that particular country. When we're designing banknotes, most banknotes stay in circulation between 7 and 10 years, so it needs to stand the test of time. The durability of these banknotes far outstretches that of paper. The number of security features that are typically within a banknote are around about 20 to 30, and those will be incorporated whether or not into the substrate, into the security thread, into different parts of the ink, again in different layers to try and deter the counterfeiter. We incorporate all of the security features into the banknote. So on this one here we have a transparent window, which is a security feature for polymer. And again, there's some covert features into the banknote as well, which when you expose the banknote to different types of light source, will reveal some security features. There are effectively three levels. Level one are typically public recognition features. So for instance, here we have this magnetic ink on it. And these are typically features that enable the public to determine that the banknote is genuine. Level two are security features that require some other teller assist. So they require either a UV lamp or a microscope to actually examine the banknote. And then level three security features, sometimes they're sleeper features which are not used or certainly not announced to the public, but the central banks hold those features in reserve to be able to sort their banknotes out if there are counterfeiting issues. For a designer and working for De La Rue's, it's to show that the product that you're producing touches the lives of everybody every day. So most people have a product in their pocket, whether or not that will be a banknote or a passport or a driving license that's been designed and developed by De La Rue.
Rainy weather was experienced over the country today. A trough of low pressure lies slow moving over the Solomons and extends southeastwards over Fiji. Meanwhile, another trough of low pressure lies over Tuvalu and extends southwards over to Wallis and Futuna and to Tonga. Recapping our major stories tonight, Fijians celebrate 43 years of independence with pomp and ceremony, as others stood in solidarity, holding a vigil and praying for the nation. And local economists go head-to-head in a heated debate on the proposed minimum wage for the country. That's Fiji One News. Remember, you can watch our news videos and updates on our Fiji One News Facebook and Twitter page, as well as our Fiji One News YouTube channel. Thanks for joining us. Have a good evening.